morning and welcome to Marion Hills Bible Church. We are so glad you have chosen us this morning to be here and to participate with us this morning. We'd like to welcome you out in the web. Thank you again for choosing us and to be a part of our service this morning. Let's bow in prayer. Father, we do thank you. Lord, you are a good and a gracious and a mighty and a holy God. And Lord, as we look at meekness today, Father, may we hear the message ring strong and true. Lord, may we understand that it's not being weak, but being strong in you. Lord, we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name.
When Frances Fanny Crosby was 6 weeks old, her parents noticed that something was wrong with her eyes. With their family doctor out of town, they contacted a man that claimed to be a physician. He looked at the infant's eyes and decided to apply hot mustard poultices. The infection did eventually clear, but the harsh treatment tragically left white scars on her eyes, and Fanny was permanently blinded. Her father passed away shortly after, and her mother went to work to provide for her blind daughter. But for God's glory, that was not the end of Fanny Crosby's story. She went on to become one of the most famous and beloved hymnists in the world, writing over 1,000 hymns. One of Fanny's dearest friends was Phoebe Knapp. While Fanny lived in the slums of Manhattan and worked in a rescue mission, Phoebe lived in a palatial residence in Brooklyn where she dressed and entertained lavishly. Her music room contained one of the finest collections of instruments in the country, and Fanny was a frequent house guest. One day, in 1873, while Fanny was staying at the Knapp mansion, Phoebe wanted to play a tune that had been running through her mind. Going to the music room, she sat at the piano and played the new composition while the blind hymnist listened. And then it happened. Fanny clapped her hands with joy and said, "Why, Phoebe, that is Blessed Assurance." Within minutes, Fanny had composed the words, and one of the great hymns of worship was born. Many years later, the great preacher D.L. Moody and his music director, Ira Sankey, were preaching to large crowds in New York. They had popularized many of Fanny's hymns and made her name famous around the world. Yet Fanny refused to even be recognized publicly when she attended Moody's crusades. At one such event, Fanny slipped in late to hear D.L. Moody speak. The church was packed and Fanny could not find a seat anywhere. Seeing what was happening, Moody's son raced off the stage to help her find a seat. To her bewilderment, she had been led onto the platform just as the crowd was singing Blessed Assurance. Moody Sr. jumped to his feet, raised his hand, and interrupted the singing. "Praise the Lord," he shouted. "Here comes the authoress." Though Fanny was embarrassed, she gave a few short words to thank God for making her a blessing to so many. Then she reluctantly took her seat amid a thunderous ovation. Humble, gracious, and mightily used by God, that was Frances Fanny Crosby. Let us never forget that God can make all things work together for our good and His glory.
Hello, everybody, and good morning. We're glad that you joined us this morning, that you chose to be a part of our service this morning as we continue on our study on the Beatitudes, which are part of the Sermon on the Mount of Jesus found in Matthew chapter 5. So if you have your Bibles, if you'd like to turn to Matthew chapter 5, that's where our text will be today. All my life, I've always been a student of history. I've always read a lot of history, ancient history, not so much modern history, but ancient history, and particularly military history, World War II, American Civil War, American Revolution, Napoleonic Wars. I've always enjoyed reading about battles and campaigns. So I've always looked at the particular aspect of the military point of view. I've studied a lot about Napoleon's campaigns and in his battles, but I've never really read a biography about Napoleon himself until recently. I recently finished a small 798 pages, if you want to call that small, biography of Napoleon, which really delved into his life as a person. And I was really kind of surprised at some of the things I learned about him. But one thing that I did come to realize, I understand now why Hitler admired Napoleon so much, because they were both cut from the same cloth. Both of them were so similar, such similar men that it's staggering. Let me give you some examples. Both of them suffered from an inflated sense of self-worth. In 1814, after his disastrous campaign in France, Napoleon was being advised to abdicate the throne, and he was resisting, and he said, "I can exist without France, but France cannot exist without me." And Hitler also, many times near the end of the war, was saying that the German people were not worthy. They've proved themselves not to be worthy of him. And when he was asked many times why he never married and had children, he would respond with, "The children of a genius have a hard life because there's so much expected of them." So an inflated sense of self-worth both these men had. Both these men would never admit when they're wrong. Napoleon's 1799 campaign in Egypt was a disaster. His 1812 campaign in Russia, a disaster. He invaded Russia with over 600,000 men and less than 50,000 ever came back. A disaster. His campaign in Germany in 1814, a disaster. Poorly planned, poorly coordinated, poorly conceived, all poorly conceived by him. Hitler's 1941 invasion of Russia, a disaster. The 1942 campaign in Stalingrad, a disaster. And then in 1944, when the invasion of France seemed imminent, Hitler refused to believe that it was going to come in Normandy. He believed that it was going to come farther east at a place called the Pas-de-Calais, and he absolutely refused to believe that it would be in Normandy. So when the invasion did come, all of their reserves were strewn all over France, and by the time they could coordinate them, it was too late, all because of him. And they would not listen to their advisors because they always knew better. They always had the best answer, and they always knew what was best. And because they never listened to their advisors, failure was always someone else's fault. Even though they didn't listen to the advisors, they didn't listen to generals, failure was never their fault. It was always someone else's fault. The generals failed them. The army failed them. The people betrayed them. The population betrayed them. Never their fault. Always someone else's fault. They were both very aggressive. They both waged war for their own glory, and they both sacrificed the youth of their country to satisfy their own ego. Both very aggressive. And one other thing about both of them, they both lived unhappy lives. Even though they accomplished so much, they both lived unhappy lives. Napoleon died in exile in 1821 in a small island in the South Atlantic off the coast of Africa. Hitler, the last couple weeks of his life, spent holed up in a bunker about 50 feet below the ground in Berlin, living his life that way, sheltered, living his life in a bunker, blaming everyone but him for the collapse of Germany until he finally ended his life. Both these men, unhappy in life. What a stark contrast the lives of these two men are compared to the people that we're going to look at today, which are the meek. Our text reads, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." That's found in Matthew chapter 5, verse 5. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. I want to look at 2 points today. I divided this verse into two points. First point, the first half of the verse, is meekness equals earthly bliss, and the second half is meekness equals heavenly bliss. So let's look at point one, meekness equals earthly bliss. What is bliss? Bliss is joy, pleasure, happiness, and that brings us to our first word, blessed. Now, whether you want to say blessed or blessed, it doesn't really matter. And Ross touched on this in the last few weeks about how this word can also mean happy. And I want to explore that more today because it really goes hand in hand with the meek and characteristic of the meek, happiness. This word is used several times in the New Testament, and the Greek word is better, I think, translated in these instances as happy. Because when you think of blessed, it can be a lot of things. But when you think of happy, that tells you something. So I want you to get trained as I'm talking this morning to keep on substituting that word happy instead of blessed. Happy are the meek. Happy are the meek. I want to flip over to Luke. If you want to flip over to Luke, don't get used to staying in Matthew because we're not going to go back there. We're going to flip through a lot of different passages this morning. Flip a couple books over to Luke, chapter 11, verses 27 and 28. We see the same word used, blessed, but if you translate it as happy, it gives you a better meaning. Starting in verse 27, Jesus is speaking to some people, and one of the people in the crowd shouts out, while Jesus was saying these things, one of the women in the crowd raised her voice and said to him, "Blessed, happy, is the womb that bore you and the breast at which you nursed." But he said, "On the contrary, blessed or happy are those who hear the word of God and observe it." Same word that's used here as describing the meek, blessed, but I think it's better translated happy. Happy are those who hear the word of God and observe it. Flip over to Revelation, the very last book in the Bible. Revelation chapter 1, verse 3. John is writing the vision of the revelation, and he says, "Blessed or happy is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and heed the things which are written in it, for the time is at near." Notice what John says. Happy are they who read and those who heed the words. What does it mean to heed? To obey. To heed a warning means to obey. So you can translate it, happy are those who read the words and who obey the words of this prophecy. And then flip over to the very last chapter in Revelation, chapter 22. John writes the same thing. Chapter 22, verse 7. Jesus is speaking. Jesus says, "Behold, I am coming quickly. Happy is he who heeds the words of the prophecy of this book. Happy are they who obey the words of this prophecy." So we have three cases here where the word happy, if inserted, is talking about happiness is a characteristic of those who obey the word of God. This blessing, this happiness, is a result of obeying God. Doing right is always the right thing. It always brings happiness. When you do wrong, you feel guilty, you're scared, you're worried if you're going to get caught. But when you do the right thing, you're happy because you know, you feel good. So this blessing, this happiness, is a result of obeying God. Now I want to look at some Old Testament verses that use this exact same word. The exact same. Flip over to Psalm chapter 1, back into the Old Testament. It's the biggest book in the Bible, so if you find Psalm, if you just open your Bible, you're more than likely going to open up into Psalm. Psalm chapter 1. I'll give you a second to get there. Psalm chapter 1. And this Hebrew word that's used here for happy, I'm sorry, for blessed, can also be translated and happy. And I think it's better translated as happy. It better suits the purpose of the meaning of the text. Chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. How blessed, happy is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scoffers. Notice it says, how happy is the man who doesn't follow the advice of the wicked. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. Notice the distinction there. The man who follows the law of the Lord and delights in the law of the Lord, to delight means to hear and to obey, you are happy, you are blessed. Flip over a few chapters over to Psalm chapter 40. Chapter 40, verse 4. And we read, how happy is the man who has made the Lord his trust. Notice that? He's made the Lord his trust. He's happy. He's blessed. He's happy because he trusts in the Lord. He obeys the Lord and he trusts in the Lord. Flip over to the right some more to Psalm 119. The longest chapter in the Bible. Psalm 119, verses 1 and 2. How happy are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. How happy are those who observe his testimonies, who seek him with all their heart. You notice that? Happy are those who obey God's law and who seek his testimonies. Happy, 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 blessed, happy are those who obey God. And one more chapter we'll look at, flip over to the left, to Psalm 128, verse 1. How happy is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. Again, happy are those who obey God. This blessing, happiness, is a result of obeying God in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. What's interesting, too, is there is a Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament, which was translated about 200 years before Jesus was born, called the Septuagint. The Greek translation uses the word that's used in Matthew chapter 5, and speaking of the happiness of the man that obeys God, it uses that word to translate this word in the Hebrew text. Same word is used. So there's a theme there between the Old and New Testament. The man, the woman, the person who obeys God and walks in his way is happy. Happy, happy, happy. The Old and New Testament both declare a state of blessing and happiness for those who obey God. You're in a state of happiness. So how are the poor in spirit happy? Happy are the poor in spirit because they've come to realize they can't save themselves and they place their faith in Jesus Christ. Happy are those who mourn? They've got forgiveness of sins. Happy are the meek? Because they're obeying God. They're obeying God, obedience to God. So that brings us now to our next question, the second part of our point one. Who are the meek? Happy are the meek. Who are the meek? Well, those who obey God. It's already been established from both Old and New Testament. Those who obey God are happy. Those who obey God are the meek. The meek. Now, let me give you some synonyms for meek. Synonyms: quiet, easily imposed on, submissive, patient, peaceful, modest, frightened, spineless, spiritless, wimpish, humble, and gentle. All those words sound bad, don't they? Our dictionary definition of meek does not put a meek person in a very good light. It makes them seem like they're weak. It makes them seem like they're scared, little things hiding in a corner. That's not what the word means. The word is better translated by humble. Some places translate it as gentle, but humble. Meekness and humility go together. If you look up humility in your dictionary, a synonym is going to be meekness. A synonym is meekness. What are some antonyms, some opposites of meekness? Assertive, overbearing, aggressive, the kind of people that we think of as like Napoleon or Hitler. You could be this kind of a way in a business environment. Politicians can be this way. You can be assertive, overbearing, and aggressive. You can also be meek if you're obeying God. But when we think of meekness, we think of weakness. Meek equals weak. But that's not how the Bible portrays meekness. The Bible portrays meekness as a state of humility. Humility. Humility isn't bad. Humility is good. Let me tell you, pride is ugly. Pride is an ugly trait. You see athletes who, after they do something, they point to their back to show you their name. They want praise. They want praise. But they don't want praise when they mess up and they drop a ball or they miss something. They don't want that kind of credit. But they want credit when they do something good. That's pride. It's ugly. Let's look at some verses where, in the New Testament, it talks about meekness. Paul, writing in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1, says, "Now I, Paul, myself urge you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ." Did you notice that? Jesus was meek. Jesus was a meek man. Now here you have God in the flesh who could have done anything. He is characterized as being a meek man. In Galatians chapter 5, Paul is writing about characteristic activities. He contrasts the works of the flesh with the works of the fruit of the Spirit. In chapter 5, starting in verse 16, Paul writes, "Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise." I've got the wrong passage here. I'm sorry, I'm in Ephesians. That's why it doesn't ring a bell to me. Galatians chapter 5, starting in verse 16, Paul writes, "But I say, walk in the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. For the flesh sets a desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you would. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, envying, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these, of which I forewarn you, just as I have forewarned you, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, gentleness, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law." There's no prohibition against those last nine characteristics. And the second to the last, gentleness, is the word that's translated as meek. Sometimes it's translated as gentle. Meekness is a fruit of the Spirit. It's a spiritual quality, a spiritual characteristic. Meekness is a spiritual characteristic. In fact, how important is meekness? Well, Paul, writing to Timothy, in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 11, Paul writes, "Flee from these things, you man of God, and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness." That's the word that's meek. That's translated as gentle. That's the word that is used in Matthew 5:5 to talk about the meek. Gentle. These are spiritual qualities, traits that are to be pursued by a godly person. You don't have to be afraid to be meek. It's an admirable godly quality to have in your life. Let's flip over to a couple Old Testament verses that talk about this. Go back to Psalm. Psalm chapter 37. Psalm chapter 37, verses 10 and 11. David writes, "Yet a little while, and the wicked man will be no more. And you will look carefully for his place, and he will not be found. But the humble will inherit the land and will delight themselves in abundant prosperity." That word that's translated as humble is the Hebrew correspondent to the word that is translated as meek. Humble. Meekness, humble, gentleness, all synonyms for each other. Notice he says, the humble will inherit the land. That's the passage where Jesus quoted from in Matthew chapter 5. He quoted from this psalm. And in Psalm 147, verse 6, the psalmist writes this about this exact same topic. 147, verse 6. We read, "The Lord supports the afflicted." The Lord supports the afflicted, right? That word afflicted there is the same word. It's translated as humble, gentle, and meek. The Lord supports the meek. The Lord supports the humble. But he brings down the wicked to the ground. The last half of that verse says, the Lord supports the humble. So, again, both Old and New Testament both show us that meekness is a humble attitude, a humble action, a humble quality in the lives of a person. To be meek is to be humble, is to be gentle. And, you know, we talked about the Septuagint. The same word that's used in this in the New Testament, the same Greek word to describe the meek, the same word that the Septuagint translated these Old Testament passages, humble and gentle, to describe the meek. Same word that's used there. So both the Old Testament and the New Testament, the meek are the humble. The meek are the humble. So why are the meek happy? Notice our passage here. Happy are the meek. Why are they happy? Well, the poor in spirit are happy because they say, I'm a sinner, I need a Savior. Those who mourn say, I'm happy because my sin is forgiven. How are the meek happy? Because they say, I need to obey God, and they do it. They obey God, and they do it. What makes them happy? Obeying God's word makes them happy, especially in one area. You can be happy because you're obeying God in all your life, but there's one area where it's so important to obey God, the very first area, the starting point, and that's when it comes to our salvation. I want to read you a couple of verses where Paul addresses this issue. In Galatians chapter 2, Galatians chapter 2, verse 16, Paul is writing, and he says this, "Nevertheless, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Christ Jesus, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, so that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by works of the law, since by the works of the law no flesh will be justified." Do you hear what Paul's saying is? There is nothing you can do that can please God, nothing that you can do that can justify yourself before God. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. Paul writes, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast." Did you catch that? You're saved by faith, not by works. It's a gift. It's a gift. What do you have to do to receive a gift? Just take it. You don't earn a gift. If you've earned a gift, it's not a gift. A gift is something given to you. Paul says here in Ephesians, it's not something that you can earn. It's not something that you can do. It's a gift. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Paul writing to Timothy, and he says in verses 8 and 9, "Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord or of me, his prisoner, but join with me in suffering for the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which he has granted us in Christ from all eternity." Notice what Paul says. We've been called not because of what we've done, but because of what Jesus already did. It's not because of what we've done. It's a gift. We can't save ourselves. And they're writing in Titus chapter 3, verse 5. Paul writes this. "He saved us not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy." See that? Not by the basis of our own works of righteousness, not by the basis of our own good works, not by the basis of anything we've done. He saved us according to his mercy. He saved us because of what Jesus did, not because of anything what we did. You see, it's 100% Jesus and not you. It's not even 1% you. It's 100% Jesus. So all these passages that we looked at tell us that you can't save yourself. God says you can't save yourself. So if God says you can't get to heaven on your own, why are you still trying to do it? Why are you still trying to offer up a life to God that you think he will accept? Maybe you're listening here and you're thinking, well, I think I've lived a pretty good life. Or, God will accept me as I am. That's pride. That's pride. Don't come to God on your terms, because that's what you're doing. You're saying, God's going to accept me. Well, that's your terms. That's not what God says. God says you can't save yourself. Nothing that you do is good enough. So don't offer to God a life maybe trying to have more good than bad and say, Lord, accept me as I am, because it's not going to work. Why offer up to God something that he says he will not accept? Don't come on your terms, which are pride. Come on his terms, meekly, humbly, and obediently. Come as meek, a meek person, obediently. So why are the meek happy? They know they can't get to heaven on their own. They're trusting in what Jesus already did for them. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3, we won't turn there, but Paul writes, Christ died for our sins. In John chapter 3, verse 16, a verse that you hear us quote many, many times, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. What does it mean to believe in Jesus? It means to place your faith in him and say, I believe that he died for my sins, and I believe that he's my Savior. Have you done that? Those of you who are listening to me, have you done that? Have you placed your faith in Jesus Christ as your Savior, or are you still trying to please God with what you can offer up to him? Are you offering up to God something of your own creation? If you are, then you need to, in obedience, humbly, meekly, and obediently come to God and offer up to God, or I'm sorry, give God what he wants, and that's just simple trust in Jesus Christ. Would you like to do that now? If you'd like to, let's do that right now. I'm going to ask everybody who's listening to just bow your heads and close your eyes. And if you're here and you've already accepted Jesus as your Savior, I'm going to ask you to pray for those who may be listening who have not accepted Jesus as their Savior. And if you're here today listening, and if I was to ask you, do you know you're going to heaven? And if you were to give me an answer like, I don't know, or I hope so, well, then I'm speaking to you. Would you like to take care of that today? We've already looked at some verses that says you can't save yourself and that Jesus died for your sin. Would you like to take care of that today? Would you like to be happy? Would you like to qualify as the meek who are happy because they obey God and they accept what God has offered them for their salvation? Would you like to do that today? If you'd like to, just pray a simple little prayer like this. Just say, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know that I've been trying to save myself and I've been wrong. Right now, I ask Jesus to be my Savior, and I ask him to forgive me for my sins, and I ask him to come into my life. Amen. And if you want to look up again, if you've done that today, if you prayed a prayer like that to ask Jesus to be your Savior because you finally realize that you can't save yourself, and based on the Word of God, Jesus died for you, and you need to ask Jesus to be your Savior, if you've done that today, I'm going to ask you to do two things. First of all, write down 1 John 5:13. Write this verse down. This verse says, John is writing to the church, and he says, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. Did you catch that word? You can know that you have eternal life. That's why the meek are happy. They know they have eternal life. I know I have eternal life. I trusted Jesus as my Savior when I was 19, many, many, many years ago. I've known since then that I have eternal life. I have a friend of mine who was dying of cancer, and back in January when I went to visit him a few days before he died, he said to me, Larry, I know I'm going to heaven because I've trusted Jesus as my Savior and I've asked him to forgive my sins and be my Savior. He wasn't happy about dying. He wasn't happy about leaving his family, but he was happy that he knew he was going to go to heaven. And I believe he's in heaven right now because he did trust Jesus. And based on the Word of God, he obediently did what the Bible tells us we need to do. He's in heaven. Have you done that? That verse tells you, you can know for sure. From now on, if you trusted Jesus as your Savior this morning, you never have to say, I hope I'm going to heaven, or I don't know if I'm going to heaven. You can say for sure, I'm going to heaven because I did what the Bible tells me I need to do. I've trusted Jesus as my Savior. And the second thing I'm going to ask you to do is, at the end of the message this morning, you're going to see our email address. I'm going to ask you to just email us. All you have to do is put three simple words, I did it. We want to know. We want to know so we can pray for you. And if you would really like more, if you are willing to give us your address and your name, we can get some literature to you. You don't have to. If you don't want to, we're not going to pressure you. But we'd like to know. Just send us a quick email and just say, I did it. We'd like to know. We'd like to pray for you. Have you done that today? So, the meek are happy because they stop trusting to save themselves. They obey God and trust Jesus, and they know that they have eternal life. That's why the meek are happy. If you did this then, along with everybody else who's listening this morning, if you did this, this verse says that you have received an inheritance. And that brings us to our second point. Meekness equals heavenly bliss. You see, the bliss in heaven and earth that we have is the happiness, the assurance of salvation, the knowledge of knowing that we're saved and we're going to heaven. Now the second part of this verse tells us that meekness equals heavenly bliss. What is that heavenly bliss? Well, first thing it says, the meek shall inherit the earth. What is an inheritance? It's a gift. It's a gift given by someone else, usually a parent, or a family member. It's given by someone else. It's a gift. You don't deserve it. You're not due it. It's not something that you are supposed to get. It's a totally a gift given to you by someone else. And that person doesn't have to be dead. They can be alive. In the Old Testament, it wasn't uncommon for people to receive an inheritance. My wife and I were just talking yesterday. We have received an inheritance from a family member 10 years ago who, at our daughter's first wedding, he said he was going to give us part of our inheritance, which was nice of him to even be thinking of us, but he thought we could use the money then. And he was right. We could use it then. And that was 10 years ago. He's still alive. In fact, we were joking yesterday. I hope he's forgotten that he gave us some of that money. I hope he's forgotten. But it's a gift. Inheritance is a gift. Let's look at our inheritance. Our inheritance. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, Peter talks about our inheritance. So an inheritance is a gift. It's something you don't deserve. It's something that someone else gives to you. 1 Peter 1, verses 3 and 4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a lively hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. Did you catch that? First of all, it's in heaven. It's reserved for you. There's an inheritance waiting for you in heaven. It will never diminish. It's undefiled. It will never rot. It's imperishable. It's waiting there for you. What is this inheritance? Well, if you want to flip back over to Psalm chapter 37, I think we already looked at this verse a little bit, but I want to look at it again because it does speak to this issue of an inheritance. Psalm chapter 37, found in verses 9 through 11. It says, evildoers will be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord, they will inherit the land. Notice that, they will inherit the land. Inheritance, inheriting the land was something that the Old Testament promised to believers, inheriting the land. So inheritance is a gift given to you when you trust Jesus, not because of anything you did for yourself, but because of what Jesus did for you. So what do the believers, what do the meek, what do they inherit? Well, the text tells us they inherit the land. Happy are the meek, for they shall inherit the land. What exactly does this mean? In Psalm 37, we won't take the time to go through all these verses, but in verses 8 to 11, it says the land. In verse 22, it tells us that they inherit the land. In verse 29, they will inherit the land. In verse 34, they will inherit the land. What does that mean, that they will inherit the land? Does it mean that they'll inherit a plot of land in Israel? What exactly does it mean? Well, one more time to flip over. Flip over to Hebrews chapter 11 back in the New Testament. It'll be the last passage we go to. Hebrews chapter 11. The beginning part of this passage, it's considered the Faith Hall of Fame because everybody in here is commended for their faith. It starts with Adam, and it goes to Abel, and it goes into Enoch, and it goes into Noah, and then it goes into Abraham. And this is what it says about Abraham and the people who went before him in verse 13. All these died in faith without receiving the promises, but having seen them and having welcomed them from a distance and having confessed that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For those who say such things make it clear that they are seeking a country of their own. And indeed, if they had been thinking of that country from which they went out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. What is the land? It's heaven. The land is heaven. What does inherit the land mean? In Jesus' time, it was a proverbial expression to denote some kind of a great blessing. The Jews considered the land a picture of heaven and a blessing under the Messiah. To inherit the land was a blessing of being in heaven under the Messiah. So what Jesus is promising here, happy are the meek, for they shall inherit the land. Jesus is promising that the meek will be received into his kingdom and partake of its blessings both now and in heaven. A spot in heaven. Land in heaven. An inheritance in heaven. In John chapter 14, as Jesus was just about to leave his disciples, he said to them, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And I'm going to prepare a place, and I'm going to come back, and I'm going to take you to that place. Jesus has a home prepared for each and every one who accepts him as their Savior in heaven. He has a place prepared for them. You see, just as it said that Abraham and the patriarchs before them, they just thought they were strangers here. This wasn't home. They were looking for a heavenly home. It's the same as true of us. Our home isn't here. Our home is in heaven, And my friend, as I was talking to him, I was telling him, when he dies, he's going home. He's going home. This isn't his home. He's going home to the place that Jesus has prepared for him. And Jesus has a place prepared for you too, if you've accepted Jesus as your Savior. So, happy are the meek, for they will inherit the land. They're happy because they're going to heaven. They know they're going to heaven, and there's a place for them in heaven. I want to close by reading a few excerpts from a book by J. Dwight Pentecost called The Work and Words of Jesus Christ. In this sermon, Christ described the characteristics of a righteous man. The Sermon on the Mount was our Lord's exposition of the holiness of God. It set forth the demands that a holy God made on those who would be accepted by him and received into Messiah's kingdom. When our Lord, however, spoke of happiness, he related it to holiness. Happiness and holiness are inseparably united in his kingdom. The first characteristic of righteousness, which Christ described, is that of poor in spirit. The truly righteous are people who have recognized they have no righteousness and turn to God to supply their need. The next characteristic of the righteous is that they mourn. But the righteous that Christ demands freely acknowledge the presence of sin in the individual. The third characteristic of the righteous is that they are meek. Meekness and obedience go hand in hand. Meekness is characterized by unquestioning submission. Christ promised that those who submit to divinely constituted authority will inherit the earth. That is, those who subject themselves to his authority will be accepted into his kingdom. The unrighteous are characterized by a self-assertive pride that leads them to refuse to submit to the authority of Christ. So again, my question is, why are the meek happy? They're happy because they've accepted Jesus as Savior. They have assurance of salvation here on earth, and they know that there's a place for them in heaven. The meek are happy because they've humbled themselves, they've obeyed God, and they have an inheritance in heaven for them. Jesus is their Savior. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much for this promise to the meek, that when each one of us comes to you meekly and realizes that we are sinners lost in our sin, and we ask Jesus to forgive us of our sin and be our Savior, he will never turn us away. Thank you that it's all about Jesus. It's not about what I can do. It's not about any righteousness that I have or anything that's in me that's good. It's all about what Jesus did for me. We thank you for that. We thank you that Jesus has promised to save us, and he's promised that there is a place for us in heaven when we leave this earth. We have an inheritance in heaven that will never fade away. And we thank you and praise you for what Jesus has done for us. Amen. We believe.
thank you for being a part of our service again today. Let's have a wonderful word of prayer. Father, we thank you for today. Lord, you are a good and gracious and a mighty and a holy God. Thank you, Father, for your truth. We pray that anyone who does not know you, has not bent their knee to you, that, Father, they would accept you as their Savior, that they would repent of their sin, turn from their wicked ways, and, Lord, allow you to work in their lives. Father, we thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you made that choice this morning and you would like to, we would like to hear from you, and please contact us at marionhillsbiblechurch@gmail.com. If you have an offering or a tithe that you would like to support with for the church, please send that to Marion Hills Bible Church, 142 Plainfield Road, Darien, Illinois, 60561. God bless you and have a wonderful week.